Kansai International Airport is one of the only floating airports in the world built on an artificial island in Osaka Bay. It was opened in 1994 and expanded in 2007, and it is considered one of the busiest and most innovative airports in Asia. But it also has a serious problem. It is sinking into the water faster than expected, and it could reach sea level by 2056. How did this happen, and what can be done to save this airport from drowning? Let's find out. To understand why Japan built a floating airport, we need to go back to the 1960s and 70s, when the Kansai region, which includes the cities of Osaka, Kyoto, and Kobe, was losing trade and business to Tokyo. Tokyo had a second airport, Narita, which opened in 1978, and many exporters had to ship their cargo there rather than use the local airport in Osaka, called Itami. Itami was located in a densely populated suburb, and it was reaching its capacity. It could not be expanded because of the noise and the opposition from the residents. It was clear that a new airport location was needed, but where to build it? The initial plan was to build the new airport near Kobe, which could serve both cities with fast transport links and which didn't have its own airport. But the city of Kobe rejected the plan, and the airport planners had to look for other options. They wanted a location away from built-up areas so that they could build a large-scale airport that could operate 24 hours a day. They also wanted to avoid the problems that Tokyo faced with the planning of Narita Airport, which faced protests and lawsuits from the rural landowners who had to give up their property for the airport. So they came up with a bold idea: to build the airport on an artificial island, 3 miles offshore in Osaka Bay. This way, they could avoid the noise, the land acquisition, and the environmental impact of building on the mainland. They also hoped that the airport would boost the economy and the tourism of the Kansai region and make it a gateway to Asia and the world. But building an airport on an artificial island was no easy task. It was one of the most ambitious and expensive civil engineering projects in history. It took 20 years of planning and construction, and it involved flattening two mountains, dredging soil from the bay and from China and Korea, building a seawall to protect the island from waves and storms, installing millions of vertical pipes to drain the water from the clay seabed, and laying layers of sand and soil to create a stable foundation for the airport. The total cost of the project was estimated at $20 billion, more than twice the original budget. The airport was designed by the famous Italian architect Renzo Piano, who was a key proponent of the high-tech architecture movement, which used the latest technology and industrial design to create innovative buildings. Piano wanted to make the airport simple and efficient, and he designed it to resemble a glider plane in plan, with a long terminal building that curved gently, lifting in the middle and decreasing at either end, so that it would not interfere with the view from the control tower. The terminal building was also the longest airport terminal in the world, with a length of 1.7 kilometers or more than a mile. It had a clear span roof that was supported by a steel structure that was visible inside the terminal, and it had skylights and blade-shaped deflectors that helped to channel the air and the sunlight. The terminal also had mobile sculptures by Susumu Shingu that hung from the roof and that moved with the airflow, creating a dynamic and elegant atmosphere. The terminal was connected to the mainland by a 3.7 kilometer bridge, and it provided air service for the nearby cities of Osaka, Kobe, and Kyoto. The airport opened on September 4, 1994, and it was hailed as a modern engineering marvel and a symbol of Japan's technological prowess and economic recovery. It was also a popular tourist attraction, attracting millions of visitors who came to see the airport island and its facilities. The airport soon became a hub for international flights, especially to Asia and Australasia, and it also hosted some domestic flights. It was expanded in 2007, with a second runway and a second terminal, which was designed for low-cost carriers. The airport also had other facilities such as a hotel, a shopping mall, a post office, an observation hall, and a wastewater treatment plant. But the airport also faced some serious challenges, both natural and man-made. The biggest challenge was that the airport was sinking into the water faster than expected. The engineers knew that the artificial island would settle or subside over time as the weight of the airport compressed the soil and squeezed out the water. They predicted that the island would subside evenly over a 50-year period before stabilizing at 13 feet above sea level. That was the minimum elevation required to prevent flooding in case of a breach in the seawall. But they underestimated how much the island would sink and how fast. By 2000, only 6 years after the opening, some parts of the island had already reached the 13-foot mark. By 2016, the island had sunk 38 feet, and it was still sinking at a rate of 6 centimeters per year. What caused this rapid sinking? There are several factors that contributed to it. One factor was the quality of the soil that was used to build the island. The soil was mostly clay, which is soft and compressible, and it was not compacted enough to support the weight of the airport. Another factor was the design of the drainage system, which was supposed to remove the water from the soil and make it more solid. The drainage system consisted of millions of vertical pipes that were filled with sand and that were supposed to act like wicks, absorbing the water from the surrounding soil and from the layers beneath. But the pipes were not effective enough, and they did not reach deep enough to drain the water from the lower layers of the soil. A third factor was the effect of the tides and the waves, which exerted pressure on the seawall and the island, and which caused the soil to shift and settle. A fourth factor was the impact of the earthquakes and the typhoons, which shook and battered the island, and which caused cracks and deformations in the soil and the structures. The sinking of the airport posed a serious threat to its safety and its operation. The sinking caused the runway and the taxiways to tilt and crack, and it also lowered the height of the seawall, making the island more vulnerable to flooding. The airport had to spend millions of dollars to repair and raise the runway and the taxiways, and to reinforce and elevate the seawall. But these were only temporary solutions, and they did not stop the sinking. Some experts predicted that by 2056, some sections of the island would sink to sea level and that the airport would have to be abandoned. How can the airport be saved from sinking? There are some possible solutions, but they are not easy or cheap. One solution is to inject cement or other materials into the soil to make it more rigid and resistant. This technique has been used in other places such as Venice, where the buildings are also sinking into the water. But this technique is costly and time-consuming, and it may not work well for the large-scale and complex soil structure of the airport island. Another solution is to build a new airport on a different location, either on the mainland or on another artificial island. This would require a new planning and construction process, and it would also face the same challenges of land acquisition, environmental impact, and public opposition. A third solution is to adapt the airport to the sinking and to make it more resilient and flexible. This could involve using modular and movable structures, such as floating terminals and runways, that could adjust to the changing elevation and conditions of the island. This could also involve using renewable energy sources, such as solar panels and wind turbines, that could reduce the carbon footprint and the operating costs of the airport. The sinking of the airport is not only an engineering problem, but also an economic, environmental, and social problem. The airport is a vital asset for the Kansai region and for Japan as a whole. It provides jobs, income, trade, tourism, and connectivity for millions of people. It also represents a source of pride and identity for the Japanese people, who have invested a lot of money and effort into building and maintaining it. The airport is also a part of the natural and cultural landscape of Osaka Bay, and it affects the ecosystem and the communities that live around it. The sinking of the airport has consequences for all these aspects, and it requires a comprehensive and collaborative approach to address them. The airport's fate depends on how the authorities and the stakeholders can find a feasible and sustainable solution to the problem, and how they can balance the economic, environmental, and social aspects of the situation. The airport's story is not over yet, and it will continue to evolve and fascinate us in the years to come.